Welcome to Bassworks. Today we're going to be continuing our series called Exploring the Song. The band is Squeeze and the song is Tempted. Let's do this! Tempted was the second single released from Squeeze's 1981 album, East Side Story, which I happen to have a copy of right here. And again, like in the last video, I bought this new, so great album, well worth keeping all these years. The album was originally planned to be a double album, with a different producer producing each side. They thought of having Nick Lowe, Dave Edmonds, Elvis Costello, and even Paul McCartney each do a side. In the end, it proved to be too complicated of a thing to put together, so the production duties ended up with Elvis Costello and engineer-producer Roger Bakirian, who Elvis had worked with on a bunch of his albums. So they were the ones that in the end handled the production duties and did a great job. Squeeze is an interesting band in that they have a songwriting team of Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook, who write most of the songs and also share vocal duties. Chris Difford writes mostly the lyrics and Glenn Tilbrook the music. Just before the recording began for East Side Story, Squeeze had changed keyboard players. Longtime member Jules Holland had left the band, and they had hired Paul Carrick, who was a singer known for the song How Long by the band Ace, and he had also just recently played with Roxy Music, an excellent vocalist and great keyboard player, so this was a great addition to the band. Glenn Tilbrook originally was going to sing Tempted, but when Elvis Costello heard Paul Carrick sing it, he just decided that that was the voice that he wanted on it. Glenn Tilbrook, I don't think, was too happy about this, but I think the results speak for themselves. Take a listen to the drums on the track. So one of the first things you notice is the leakage on there. On the overheads, you can hear the bass, organ, and you can even hear a lead vocal that sounds like Glenn Tilbrook singing the song. Yeah, interesting. So this was definitely a live take with those instruments, with Glenn Tilbrook singing. Let's bring the bass in. You can hear it on the overheads a little bit, but let's bring it in on its own. Here we go. So you can hear a little leakage on that too, so it must have been a amp in the room a little bit, although most of it sounds like a direct signal. Ooh, mistake on the keyboards. Didn't make the final mix. So real straight ahead meat and potatoes drums on it. Crashes. Ooh. Very sparse drumming throughout with the bass pumping those eighth notes. Live track they did. Okay. very aggressive bass playing that he's doing, kind of hitting down on the strings a little bit, give it a more of a percussive sound. Ooh, drum fill. The gaff on the keyboards on that that didn't make it into the final. Good stuff. There's nothing like a live rhythm take like this. Obviously, the band was all in the studio in the same room, and they took the track, the drums and bass on it, and the organ mostly, and the lead vocal obviously was replaced later. It's a real band, I love it. Keyboard improvisation in there on the organ. Ooh. So this is after the fade out on the album. Interesting to hear. Having some fun. Interesting, an actual ending on it. So the complete band for East Side Story included Chris Difford on guitar and vocals, Glenn Tilbrook on guitar, vocals, and some keyboards, Gilson Lavis on drums, John Bentley on bass and backing vocals, and Paul Carrick on keyboards and vocals. Prior to joining Squeeze, Gilson Lavis had worked with Jerry Lee Lewis, Chuck Berry, and even Dolly Parton, done a lot of touring, so he was a seasoned drummer, and you can hear how solid he is in the tracks. John Bentley is a great bass player, and he played on some of the best Squeeze stuff that ever came out. The albums Argy Bargy, of course East Side Story, and also the follow-up Sweets from a Stranger. So some great bass lines on all of the songs on there. He was originally taught by Trevor Boulder, who was David Bowie's early bass player in the Spiders of Mars. So kind of interesting there. Two really successful guys that knew each other that ended up out on the road doing some great things. So what a great rhythm track. Those drums are just rock solid all through. Build a little bit, but pretty simple playing throughout. Just laying it down for the band. Bass and drums locked tight on it. And that organ track is probably 99% what we're hearing on the final mix. Couple little parts in there that they obviously covered over or recut on one of the other tracks. But it's interesting, one of the things we don't hear on there is any guitar in that leakage. And there's also a lot of piano on the track too, which isn't in there. And of course, Paul Carrick's lead vocal. So let's take a listen to some of those other elements right now. Let's listen to Paul Carrick's vocal on the track.
I bought a toothbrush, some toothpaste, a flannel for my face, pajamas, a hairbrush, new shoes and a case. I said to my reflection, let's get out of this place.
Great vocal.
Past the church and the steeple, the laundry on the hill, the billboards and the buildings, memories of it still keep calling and calling. But forget it all, I know I will.
Real powerful singer, great pitch.
Tempted by the fruit of another.
So soulful.
Tempted, but the truth is discovered. What's been going on? And now that you have gone, there's no other. Tempted by the fruit of another.
That is amazing. Just one of the greatest vocalists there are.
Tempted, but the truth is discovered.
Man, just incredible singing.
I'm at the car park.
So now we have Glenn Tilbrook.
The baggage carousel.
The people keep on
and Elvis Costello.
And wishing I was well.
I said it's no occasion.
It's no story I can tell.
Back to Elvis.
At my bedside,
back
empty
to Paul
pocket.
Carrick.
A foot without a sock. Your body gets much closer. I fumble for the clock. Alarm by the seduction. I wish that it would stop. Tempted by the fruit of another.
You can hear how the vocal was just recorded separately because you don't hear that bleed of all the other tracks in it like we had on the original.
Now that you have gone, there's no other. Tempted by the fruit of another. Tempted, but the truth is discovered.
So we've got a great chord progression in here. So we start off with B. Then we do B over A. Then we've got E with G sharp. And then down to E. So our verse, we start on the B. We have B over A sharp, then we have G sharp minor, then we have a C sharp 7, and then an E minor 7, then we have B minor 7, F sharp minor 7, then we have a G with A in the bass, followed by A, D, then we go to E, to G, to B, a couple of really interesting chords here. We have an A with E in the bass, then we have an F augmented, then we have D with F sharp in the bass, down to E, back to D with F sharp in the bass, and then we have a G7 with an F bass. So he plays a 9 down to it, so it's... Then we have an E, an E over D. So let's talk about the melody on this. One of the things that really surprised me when I started working on this song was just how in-depth the music was and just how creative and how many amazing things I found in it. And the melody was sure that... most of the notes are out of the chords in the melody, but there's a lot of ninths and there's some fourths and flat sevens and things like that. So let's take a look at that right from the beginning. So we start off with a B chord. The melody notes that we use, there's only four notes. And over the B chord, they're root, second, third, and fifth. So the root, third, and fifth are right in that B chord. So with just that second added in. Now the same thing over the B with A sharp in the bass. We're still using the root, third, and fifth of the B chord. And then when we get down to the G sharp minor, we're playing a fourth of the chord and then down to the third. So we're using the 4-3-4-5-3. So listen to that part again. So beautiful melody over that. And interesting bass movement too, because you've got... then the chords by themselves. So then we go to a C sharp 7, and here are our melody notes. So we've got the root, 5, root, and then flat 7. So that's starting on the second. So So then on the E minor 7, we have that second, which sounds in my ear like a 9 there. Same note, but just kind of how the function is a little bit different. So it sounds like a 9 there because it lands right when the chord does. The other, when it was the second, they're anticipating the chord change. So our next part, we've got a B minor 7. So instead of being in B major now, we've got a B minor. So we've modulated into this B minor. And here's what the melody does over that. And again, the second note is starting it, but it's anticipating the chord change. So it's just before the chord change. On the change itself, we're on the third. So that one you don't hear as a 9 because it's actually a scale note that's going right into the chord. So we've got 1, 2, 3, and 5 on that. Then we go down to F sharp minor. On our F sharp minor 7, we've got a flat 7, 6, 5. On this next chord change, it's a G with an A bass. So we're playing the third. So the melody is the third. So next we modulate to E. That's the fifth and the flat 7. Then we go to G with the major 7 on the melody. So we're going 7, 6 to 5. Then we're back to B major, which is 3, 4, 5, 1, 3, 5. So there's a lot to this song. Even just trying to explain all these chord changes, it's quite a bit. Squeeze songs are a lot more complicated than you might think when you first listen to them. So they're kind of like a lot of jazz chords in them. Seeing them live, I mean, they're moving all over the place chord-wise. And Glenn Tilbrook and Chris Difford are singing, and especially Glenn Tilbrook playing all those chord changes while he's singing. It's pretty impressive. This next part is really interesting. We've got an A chord with E in the bass, and then we go to an F augmented. And the melody that is being played over that is... So we've got this half-step root motion. So on the first chord, the melody is 5-4-3. But the 3 ends up being the sharp 5 on this F augmented chord. So here's the continuation of the melody. So that part is a D with F sharp in the bass. Down to E. And we go back to the D with F sharp. So we've got this D over F sharp, which is the third to the 9. Then that's followed by just a chord change, which is the G9 to G7 over an F bass. But our melody adds another interesting element into it. So we're playing 3, 5, 6, which on the dominant chord would be a 13. On the E chord, we have a root, flat 7 down to 5, and the E bass note goes down to D also. Then we're into the chorus. So a lot of information there. So I went through it in depth because it's pretty interesting stuff for sure. So let's take a look at the melody on the chorus. So we start with the third of the B chord, this D sharp. But what changes is when we go down to the A, it becomes a sharp 4 of the A. So it's kind of a Lydian sound there. As opposed to being the third. So that's a real interesting part there, getting that Lydian sound into it. So that is just 9-1 with the third in the bass and then down to the root. So here's the whole part again. Same thing on the second line. So the next phrase, we're still in the E chord, so we've got the fifth and third of E, but then we go down to C sharp, and that ends up being the fifth, flat seven, and root of C sharp. And then here we go down to F sharp, so those same notes now become the second, fourth, and the fifth. So on here, it's 5 flat 7 root, then down on the F sharp is 2, 4, 5. So it's a two of the sus notes, a sus 2 and a sus 4, just quickly. So there's a, we do that chord change on there, the F sharp sus. Then the transition back in. So when we get back to the B, we've got kind of a bluesy part there where we go up to the 5. So it's 5, flat, 3, 2, 1. Then at the end, we've got this part over E. So we're playing the E, third, down to the second, third, fourth, with an E bass. So the piano track was definitely overdubbed after, because you can't hear any of that on that basic track. And some different, a little bit different voicings than the organ played, and some other movement in it that's really nice. It's a real solid part. So let's talk about some of the variations that happen on this, on the keyboards. So to start, we get that high B on the organ. Some nice interplay between the two parts. So playing the same chord changes, but with a little variation on it. So the piano part was overdubbed afterward, the organ pretty much all on the basic track. So it adds a little bit of movement to it. So we've got this A to B part that's kind of a hook in there in the guitar. It's kind of a little celeste kind of sound in there. You can hear a little tambourine and these backing vocals. A Motown kind of thing to it. It's another variation on the backing vocals. Guitar part throughout. It's really the only guitar on the song. You can hear too that other piano part that's playing the A to B is a brighter piano sound than the one that's playing throughout, so it's another track. part added in. More variation on the piano. Some nice chord voicings. That hook again coming in, A to B along with the guitar part, occasional tambourine. There's some good production ideas that are added in on it. The other thing that's interesting to me on the track is it's, for the time period, 1981, it's pretty dry recording. There is reverb, but not compared to what was going on at the time with the great big gated reverbs and things that recordings were using. It's kind of old school in that regard. So some great stuff added in on there. Really helps to give a little bit more production to the track. Some other guitar stuff that you don't notice in there happening. A little soloing on it. Chris Difford always plays that part live, but I'm not sure who played it in the studio, but he always plays that part live when Glenn Tilbrook sings the lead vocal. Good stuff. All right, well, that's all for today. Hope you enjoyed the video, and don't forget to hit subscribe if you'd like to see more.